Hello learners, welcome to Senior Secondary Environmental Science course of NIOS. As you know, water falls as the rainfall or snow melt, either lost as surface runoff, water found underneath the soil, some amount of also percolates through soil under the influence of gravity and get collects in the soil pore spaces due to the presence of underlying above the impervious layer. This is underground water. We will discuss about the groundwater resources which are vitally important for agriculture, industries and day-to-day living. During this program, I am Neelam Gupta, course coordinator of environmental science. Welcome to this program of NIOS. So the objective of this program are: recall the difference between surface water and groundwater, list various ways in which groundwater can be obtained, suggest methods of economical use of water in our homes, describe how the groundwater is recharged naturally and through human agencies, highlight the risk of depletion of water, groundwater if not properly managed. Now come to the surface water and groundwater. Water and water vapor are in constant circulation, powered by the energy from sunlight and gravity as a natural process called hydrologic cycle. Water evaporates from the ocean and land. Surface is held temporarily as water vapor in the atmosphere and falls back to the Earth's surface as precipitation. Details has already discussed in lesson 27A, global circulation of water. Sources of all fresh water on Earth is rainfall. When rainfall occurs, part of it flows on the surface of the land as runoff, which ultimately gets into a water body like a stream, river, pond or lake. This water is called surface water. Part of the precipitation infiltrates below the ground surface into the soil zone. In low areas, it emerges in springs and streams as shown in figure in next slide. That is hydrological cycle. Both surface water and groundwater eventually return to the ocean, where evaporation replenishes the supply of atmospheric water vapor. Wind carries the moist air over land, precipitation occurs and the hydrologic cycle continues. The process of precipitation replenishes the groundwater supply is known as recharge. Recharge occurs only during the rainy season in tropical climates or during spring season in temperate climates. About 10 to 20% of the precipitation that falls to the earth percolates through soil and contributes to the water bearing strata, that is aquifer. Groundwater is constantly in motion. It moves very slowly. The actual rate depends on the transmissibility and storage capacity of the aquifer. Sometimes outflows of water take place through springs and river beds. Underground water body is created called aquifer. When the soil zone becomes saturated, water percolates downward. A zone of saturation occurs where all the soil pores are filled with water. Part of the renewal time of groundwater near the water table may be a year or less. While in deep aquifer, it may be as long as thousands of years. The rainwater slowly infiltrates into the soil under the pull of gravity. Sometimes outflows of groundwater takes place through springs and river beds. Water table, now come to the water table. Water table is the upper level of an underground surface in which the soil or rocks are permanently saturated with water. It is also called groundwater table. At the water table, labeled the pore space in the soil is completely filled with water. The water table separates the groundwater zone that lies below it from the capillary fringe or zone of aeration that lies above it. The water table fluctuates both with the seasons and from year to year because it is affected by rainfall, uptake by roots of different forest trees and climatic variations. Water table also affected by the quantum withdrawal from wells or by artificial recharging. It is exploited for domestic use, livestock and irrigation since time immemorial. In India, a very large percentage of population depends on groundwater for domestic needs. Now come to the difference between surface water and groundwater. Surface water is the water which remains on the surface of soil of land in form of stream, river, pond or lake. Groundwater is a water which is normally found underground and is obtained by digging wells, tube wells and hand pumps. Surface water is exposed and can be easily contaminated. Underground water is underground and thus cannot be easily contaminated. It often needs to be transported to the place of use and is thus expensive. Groundwater is often available at the place of their use and need not to be transported. It is thus cheaper. It cannot be directly consumed as surface water. Groundwater is mostly uncontaminated and can be directly consumed. It is exposed and subject to evaporate losses and thus less dependable at times of drought. Underground water is underground and lies not get lost. The loss due to evaporation, it is thus more dependable in times of drought. Now come to the global groundwater sources. The value of an aquifer depends on the porosity of the geologic layer of which it is formed. Water is withdrawn from an aquifer by pumping it out of a well or infiltration gallery. An infiltration gallery typically includes several horizontal perforated pipes radiating outward from the bottom of a large diameter vertical shaft. Wells are constructed in several ways depending on the depth and nature of the aquifer. Wells used for public water supply, usually more than 100 feet deep and from 4 to 12 inches in diameter, must penetrate large aquifer that can provide dependable yields of good quality water. A submersible pump driven by an electric motor can be used to raise the water to the surface. Now come to the methods of groundwater abstraction. There are various ways to obtain groundwater. First one is spring. The water table generally follows the topography of the ground surface. The slope in the water depth table profile results in subsoil flow. The flow depends on slope and permeability. When the water table is above the surface water level is some hilly areas, groundwater flows out as a spring. This spring water can be easily used as source of drinking. Next is dug well. It covers ordinary open wells of varying dimensions dug or sunk from the ground surface into water bearing stratum to extract water for irrigation purposes. There are broadly masonry wells, kaccha wells and duck combo wells. All such schemes are of private nature belonging to individual cultivator. The oldest water supply to town as in Rome, Lyon were from such sources. Third one is shallow well. It consists of a bore hole built into ground with the purpose of tapping groundwater from porous zones. The depth of a shallow tube well does not exceed 60 to 70 meters. The tube wells are generally operated for 6 to 8 hours during irrigation season. Next is deep tube well. It usually extends to the depth of 100 meter and more of its design to give a discharge of 100 to 200 cubic meter per hour. These tube wells operate round the clock during the irrigation season. Depending upon the availability of water, their annual output is roughly 15 times than that of an average shallow tube well. Next is hand pump, which are commonly used to draw groundwater in villages and slum areas in urban centers. These are manually operated, thus no electricity or other power is required to operate them. Now come to the economic use of water at home. Economic use of water can have major environmental, public health and economic benefits by helping to improve water quality, maintain aquatic ecosystem and protect drinking water resources. Efficiency measures can also save money on water and energy bills. Saving of water at home can be bathroom, kitchen and laundry, garden and landscaping and equipments. First, we will take bathroom. In bathroom, do not let the water run while shaving or brushing teeth. Use mug while shaving or brushing teeth. Take short showers instead of tub baths. Turn off the water while soaping or shampooing. If you must use a tub, close the drain before turning on the water and fill the tub only half full. Bathe small children together. Never use your toilet as a waste basket. In kitchen and laundry, simple practices save a lot of water. Store drinking water in refrigerator. Wash fruits and vegetables in a basin. Use a vegetable brush. Do not use water to defrost frozen foods. Then, ahead of use, scrape rather than rinse dishes before loading into the dishwasher. Add food waste in your compost pile instead of using the garbage disposal. Wash only full loads of laundry and use the appropriate water label or load size selection on the washing machine. Note, you can think homes with high proficiency plumbing fixtures and appliances save about 30% of indoor water use and yield substantial savings on water, sewer and energy bills by applying these small tips. Depending on climate, up to 75% of homes' total water use during the growing season is for outdoor purposes. Detect and repair all leaks irrigation system. Use properly treated wastewater for irrigation whenever available. Water the lawn and or garden during the coolest part of the day, that is early morning is best. Do not water on windy days. Water trees and shrubs which have deep root systems for a longer time and less frequently than shallow rooted plant that frequently require smaller amount of water. Check with the local extension service for advice on watering needs on in your area. Set sprinklers to water the lawn or garden only, not the street or sidewalk. Use soakers, hoses or trickle irrigation systems for trees and shrubs. Install moisture sensors on sprinkle systems. Use mulch around shrub and garden plants to reduce evaporation from the soil surface and to cut down on weed growth. Minimize or eliminate fertilizing, which promotes new growth needing additional watering. Do not use water that contains bleach, automatic dishwashing detergent or fabric softener for irrigation. Next is equipment. Install low flow faucets, aerators and shower heads. Consider purchasing a high efficiency washing machine which can save over 50% on in laundry water and energy use. Repair all leaks. A leaky toilet can waste about 1000 liters per day. To detect leaks in the toilet, add food coloring in the tank water. If the colored water appeared in the bowl, the toilet is leaking. Next is outdoor uses. How can we save water? Sweep driveways, sidewalks and steps rather than using hose pipes to wash them. Wash the car with water from a bucket or consider using a commercial car wash that recycles water. When using a hose, control the flow with an automatic shut-off nozzle. Avoid purchasing recreational water toys which require a constant stream of water. Consider purchasing a new water-saving swimming pool filter. Use a pool cover to reduce evaporation when pool is not being used. Do not install or use ornamental water features unless they recycle the water. Use signs to show the public that water is recycled. Do not operate during a drought. Now come to the artificial charge. The increasing demand for water has increased awareness towards the use of artificial discharge to augment groundwater supplies. Or artificial discharge is a process by which excess surface water is directed into the ground, either by spreading on the surface, by using recharge wells, or by altering natural conditions to increase infiltration. Artificial recharge, sometimes called plant recharge, is a way to store water underground in times of water surplus to meet the demand in times of shortage. Now come to the direct artificial recharge. First is spreading basins. Repeat. First is spreading basins. This method involves surface spreading of water in basins which are excavated in the existing terrain. For effective artificial recharge, highly permeable soils are suitable, and maintenance of a layer of water over the highly permeable soils is necessary. Next is recharge pits and shafts. Often areas of low permeability lies between the land surface and water table. In such situation, artificial recharge systems such as pits and shafts could be effective. Unfiltered run of water leaves a thin film of sediment on the sides and bottoms of the pits, which require maintenance in order to sustain the high recharge rates. Excavation for making pits and shafts may terminate above the water table label or may be hydraulic connectors extend below the water table. Recharge rates in both shafts and pits may decrease with time due to accumulation of fine-grained materials and the plugging effect brought about by microbial activities. Next is ditch. A ditch is a long narrow trench with its bottom width less than its depth, and its system can be designed to suit the topographic and geologic conditions that exist at a given edge site. The ditches could terminate in a collection ditch designed to carry away the water that does not infiltrate. This would reduce the accumulation of fine material. Next is recharge wells. Recharge or injection wells are used to directly recharge water into deep water bearing zones. Recharge wells are suitable only in areas where a thick impervious layer exists between the surface of the soil and the aquifer to be replenished. They are also advantages where land is scarce. A relatively high rate of recharge can be attained by this method. Now come to the indirect methods of recharging. First is enhanced stream bed infiltration or induced infiltration. This method consists of setting a gallery or a line of wells parallel to the bank of a river and at a short distance from it. Without the wells, there would be unimpeded outflow of groundwater into the river. When a small amount of groundwater are withdrawn from the gallery parallel to the river, the amount of groundwater discharged into the river decreases. Figure shows induced infiltration. The water recovered by the gallery consists natural groundwater. Each groundwater withdrawal is accompanied by a drawdown in the water table. Next is conjunctive wells. It is one that is screened in both a shallow confined and deep artesian aquifer. Water is pumped from the deeper aquifer, and when its surface is lowered below the shallow water table, water from the shallow aquifer drains directly into the deeper aquifer. Water augmentation by conjunctive wells has the advantage of utilizing sediment-free groundwater without damaging clogging well screens. Now come to the advantages of artificial recharge. First, very few special tools are needed to dig drainage wells. Groundwater recharge stores water during the wet season for use in the dry season when demand is highest is second. Third one, aquifer water can be improved by recharging well with high quality injected water. Fourth, recharge can significantly increase the sustainable yield of an aquifer. Recharge methods are attractive, particularly in arid regions. Most aquifer recharge systems are easy to operate. Recharge with less saline surface water or treated effluent improve the quality of saline aquifer, facilitating the use of the water for agriculture and livestock. Now come to the disadvantages of artificial recharge. In the absence of financial incentive, laws or other regulation to encourage landowners to maintain drainage wells adequately, the wells may fall into disrepair and ultimately become sources of groundwater contamination. There is a potential for contamination of the groundwater from injected surface runoff, water runoff, especially from agricultural fields and road surfaces, unless the surface water runoff is not pre-treated before injection. Groundwater plays an important role in India, particularly as a drinking water source, and has a number of unique features. First, generally uncontaminated and thus can be consumed directly without any treatment. It can be available in close proximity to place for its widely distributed and less expensive. It is dependable and relatively less affected by drought. Nearly 85% of India's population today is dependent on groundwater for their domestic demands. It is an important source of drinking water in rural areas. Groundwater also plays an important role in agriculture. Industrial demand for groundwater are also high. Groundwater quality is being increasingly threatened by agricultural, urban and industrial waste, which leach or are injected into underlying aquifers. Once pollution has entered the subsurface environment, it may remain concealed for many years and become dispersed over wide areas, rendering groundwater supplies unsuitable for human uses. Now come to the reason for declining groundwater quality. A vast majority of groundwater quality problems are caused by contamination, overexploitation, or combination of the two. Most groundwater quality problems are difficult to detect as they may be concealed below surface. They are also hard to resolve. Industrial discharges, landfill, and subsurface injection of chemicals and hazardous waste are an obvious source of groundwater pollution. These concentrated sources can be easily detected and regulated, but the more difficult problem is associated with diffuse sources of pollution like leaching of agrochemicals and animal waste, subsurface discharges from latrines and septic tanks, and infiltration of polluted urban runoff and seaways where sewerage does not exist or defunct. Diffuse sources can affect entire aquifer, which is difficult to control and treat. The only solution to diffuse sources of pollution is to integrate land use with water management. Table shows land use activities and their potential threat to groundwater quality in next two slides. First, land use and activities potential to groundwater pollution. First, we will take residential activities, unsewered sanitation, land and stream discharge of sewage, sewage oxidation ponds, sewage leakage, solid waste disposal, landfill, road and urban runoff, aerial fallout are the activities which have potential to groundwater pollution. Next is industrial and commercial activities, processed water, effluent lagoon, land and stream discharge of effluent, tank and pipeline leakage and accidental spills, well disposal of effluents, aerial fallout, poor housekeeping, spillage and leakage during handling of material are the activities which have potential to groundwater pollution. Next is mining. Mining drainage discharge, process water, sludge lagoon, solid mine tailing, oil field spillage at group gathering stations in rural areas, cultivation with agrochemicals, irrigation with wastewater, soil salinization, livestock rearing, and coastal areas. Activities such as salt water intrusion has potential to groundwater pollution. Now come to the common groundwater contaminants. First, nitrate. Dissolved nitrate commonly contaminate groundwater. High level of nitrate can cause blue baby disease in children, maybe form carcinogens, and can accelerate eutrophication in surface waters. Sources of nitrate include sewage, fertilizers, air pollution, landfill, and industries. Next is pathogen. Poor hygiene of well and inadequate segregation of drainage charcoal from wells may cause pathogenic contamination of good water seepage from solid waste dumps, and municipal drains may also cause pathogenic contamination. Bacteria and viruses cause waterborne diseases such as typhoid, cholera, dysentery, polio, and hepatitis may pass into groundwater through discharges from sewage, landfill, septic tanks, and livestock shelters. Third is trace metal, which include lead, mercury, cadmium, copper, chromium, and nickel. These metals can be toxic and carcinogenic. Seepage of industrial and mine discharges, fly ash, pond of thermal power plants can lead to metal in groundwater. In India and Bangladesh, millions of people are exposed to groundwater contaminated with high levels of arsenic, a highly toxic and dangerous pollutant. It has been estimated that close to 5 million people in West Bengal, India are affected. Next is organic compound. Seepage of agricultural runoff loaded with organic compounds like pesticides and may cause pesticide pollution of groundwater. Now come to the risk of depletion of groundwater. The demand for water has increased over the years, and this has led to water scarcity in many parts of the world. About 2 billion people, approximately one third of the world's population, depend on groundwater supply, withdrawing about 20% of global water annually, much it from shallow aquifers. Groundwater problems are becoming increasingly serious in many areas of the world. Rapid increase in the rate of pumping groundwater in many aquifers has caused a steady lowering of water levels, where extraction of water has exceeded rates of recharge. Now come to the Causes of groundwater depletion. First, it has been caused by human action during the past two decades. The water level in several parts of India has been falling rapidly due to an increase in extraction. The number of wells drilled for irrigation of both food and crop cash crops have rapidly and indiscriminately increased. India's rapidly rising population and changing lifestyles has also increased the domestic need for water. The water requirement for the industry also shows an overall increase. Intense competition among users and agriculture, industry and domestic sector is steadily lowering the groundwater table. Groundwater risk. The groundwater plays an important role in sustaining India's green revolution. The high yielding varieties of crops, which all increasing agricultural productivity, dependent on the timely application of water. Falling water table in several states now threaten agricultural sustainability. This has been increased by policies for cheap electricity and the absence of a property rights structure for water withdrawal. Flood and drought thus constitute the extreme manifestation of hydrologic cycle. The situation is exacerbated due to depleting forest cover in the country. Before we wrap up, we would like to recap the main points once again as what you have learned. Source of all water, fresh water or earth is rainfall. The rainwater which gets accumulated in ponds, lakes or flows in the rivers is called surface water. Part of rainwater that infiltrates the earth's surface slowly seeps downward into extensive layers of porous soil and rock. This is called groundwater. The process of precipitation replenishing the groundwater is known as recharge. The depth at which the pore space in the soil is completely filled with water and the level at which this occurs is called the water table. Water from underground has been exploited for domestic use for livestock and irrigation since time immemorial. Groundwater can be extracted through dug wells, tube wells, hand pumps or springs. Artificial recharge is a process by which excessive surface water is directed into the ground, either by spreading on the surface, by using recharge wells, or by altering natural conditions to increase infiltration to replenish an aquifer. Artificial recharge can be achieved through recharge pit, shafts, wells, ditches, or spreading basins. It can also be achieved through enhanced stream bed infiltration or conjunctive wells. Artificial recharge may degrade the groundwater quality if the recharge water is contaminated. The demand for water has increased over the years and this has led to water scarcity in many parts of the world. Rapid increase in the rates of pumping of groundwater in many aquifers has caused a steady lowering of water table levels where extraction has exceeded rates of recharge. Depletion of groundwater increases pumping cost, causes wells and rivers to dry up, and in coastal regions, seawater can intrude in groundwater. Dear learners, this is all about groundwater resources. We will come again and meet you with a new program of environmental science course. Thank you.